So again, welcome to today's lab. This is Mindy Hershey, your instructor, and we're going to be talking about the 9 elements of digital citizenship and focusing on the elements mainly as they relate to portions of intellectual property and the way that we work with media, multimedia, and our writing and our, you know, creative creations and things that you guys do digitally. So this is really important. It doesn't matter what industry you're in, right? So naturally, these things could be seen as parts of digital communication, digital ethics. They could tie into digital law, you know, lots of the elements of digital citizenship that we'll be talking about today. So one thing that you guys started doing last week was working with research, right? Utilizing the research databases of the Full Sail Library. And you looked into EBSCOhost, LexisNexis, and AP Images, right? So one thing that we had you do last week, well, actually two things that lend itself to what we're talking about this week, was getting permalinks from LexisNexis, right, for your sources. The week before, we started priming you guys on that via use of DIGO and naturally doing some research, getting used to the concepts, but adding links and things where you could have a link to your resource library for citing, right? And then adding, you know, the permalinks and a link in your presentation last week, along with image IDs, right? So everybody remembers that, right? Grabbing the image ID for those images that you retrieved from AP Images. So multimedia also needs to be sourced. So a lot of people think that, you know, if I add an image to my presentation, I don't need to cite it. Or I can just, you know, grab an image from the web and I can throw it in my presentation or put it on my website because, you know, I'm advertising for something, my music, I'm a graphic designer, whatever you might be doing, whatever your business is, whatever your role is. But it doesn't matter if you're a professional in the industry or if you're not. I mean, even if you're just somebody who's utilizing materials, you still have to adhere to the guidelines of, you know, intellectual property like copyright. So we'll talk about some of these things today. And again, we started working with some of those things without really saying, you know, what or why last week with grabbing the permalinks to cite those images by utilizing databases that you guys have the licensing rights to use because we pay for those at Full Sail. That's another big thing, whether or not you have, you know, licensing rights to utilize material. And getting you in the habit of doing some citations there with the links and the image IDs for those images. So anytime you use an image, a video, anything, writing, anything that is someone else's, it needs to be cited. And we want you guys to be in the habit at Full Sail of not utilizing materials that are copyrighted. Because as professionals, you can't do that, right? Even if you have your own business, if anybody is, you know, currently doing work for anybody else or for yourself, and you put these materials out there, maybe on your website, or you add some music to your video to advertise your product and you put that on YouTube, that's a violation of copyright if you don't have permission to use it, if it's copyrighted material. Everybody with me? Okay, so now as students, you have some protection, like when you create assignments, but where you can utilize something, you know, as a student and cite it, you know, and it's okay because it's not in the commercial realm and you have that ability as a student. But at Full Sail, we don't even want you to be in that habit. We want you to be in the habit of utilizing materials that anybody could use and that you could use at any time, like in a commercial atmosphere. And also that, you know, or something that you've created yourself. So that's the other thing. So we'll look into some ways that you can do that today. And we'll look at some of the different resources. Okay, so when we talk, oh, that's okay, Michael. Mickey, glad that you were able to join us. That's good. So yeah, so anytime if you guys need to come into the session late, as far as I'm concerned, for me, that's absolutely fine. I'd rather have you here than not. And if you miss too much of it, naturally, you can always watch the archive at the beginning of that. Okay, so if we think about resources that are out there, and if we think about whether or not we're allowed to utilize this resource, the first thing, yes, the archive is your friend. The first thing that comes to mind is, you know, copyrighted material, right? And whether material is copyrighted or not. Okay, so as far as copyright goes, by the way, if you create something on your computer, you're protected by copyright. You're protected by the United States Copyright Office, regardless of if you've published that material or not. Okay? So copyright provides a higher level of protection, and it provides an official level of protection, right? Because if you register it with the Copyright Office, then it's apparent, and there's no gray area as to who actually created the material, who owns it, all of that. No, it's not free, but it's very inexpensive. So as like a service to the general public, the Copyright Office makes it very, very inexpensive. So I think it's around like, I can't remember, but it's under $100. You know, they change the price from time to time. Remember, Matthew, it's the same attendance form for each week for my labs, right? So remember I'd said to bookmark my form. Yes, thank you, Mickey, for adding that. I was just adding that too. So yeah, there it is. Mickey and I both added that. So there's my attendance form, same one. Okay, so we're here at the copyright.gov official site. So you guys can pull up this website and you can look at it on your own, either with me or whenever you'd like to do that. And you can see that if you want to register a copyright, all you have to do is click here. And, you know, you have all the things that you need in order to register it. So they call this the ECO, the Electronic Copyright Office. So it says right here, the current processing time, if you did decide to copyright some of your materials, is generally up to 8 months. So obviously they're getting tons and tons and tons of, you know, materials that they have to copyright, right? Because, you know, anybody in the U.S. who's creating something, whether it's a movie, a video, regardless if it's, you know, a 15-year-old sitting on their computer at home or a movie producer, right? Everybody's awarded and afforded the same level of protection from the U.S. Copyright Office. So they naturally have to, you know, deal with volumes of information. So it takes up to, you know, generally, as they're saying, up to 8 months in order to get something formally copyright protected and registered naturally with their office. So if you, so that's if you do it online right here through the website. But if you did it via paper form, it tells you here generally up to 13 months. And then you can see where you can log in here and check the status of your application. So they've got all different kinds of, you know, facts, FAQs and things about it where you can look into that to see. But, and naturally, you know, this is the faster way to do it if you're interested in doing it. So if we take a look at their, if we take a look at their facts, FAQs about copyright. Okay, so if we look here at what does copyright protect, it tells you that, you know, a form of intellectual property law protects original works of authorship, including literary, dramatic, musical, and artistic works, such as poetry, novels, movies, songs, computer software, and architecture. So it tells you here, so if you, you know, have an image, a movie, a song, something like that, that you want to protect, then naturally, you know, you would come to the Copyright Office to protect one of those. I'm sorry, folks. I forgot to put my phone on silent. It's probably a student calling. All right, let me shut that off on silent. Okay, there we go. All right. So it tells you, you know, but certain things can't be protected, like, you know, through the Copyright Office, that is, they can't be copyright protected, like an idea, a system, a way of doing something, you know, facts. Some of those different things can be trademarked, right? Or different things can be patented, exactly as Hamilton's bringing up. You'll learn more about these things later in your program. So we're just talking about this today as it relates to the 9 elements of digital citizenship. And yes, and it's saying you guys are putting in some good information here. It's very inexpensive. It's well under $100. I know that. I can't remember the exact price right this moment, but we can look at that. And Gary's saying it only lasts 100 years and then it's free to duplicate such works, right? And we'll talk about that in a moment, Gary. So, and yes, they're very different, copyrights and patents. And patents can take a long time to get a patent for something. And it's a lot more, detailed and that kind of thing. Because patents a lot of time involve, you know, actually the creation of something and how it's made and, you know, different things like that. So, yeah. So, or trademarks, you know, and obviously if we think of like companies, oh yeah, watch a lot of Shark Tank, that's good. And if we think about different things, you know, where it says right here, how is copyright different from a trademark? So right here, it tells you that the copyright protects original works of authorship. What a patent protects are inventions or discoveries. So if you invent something, you would patent it. But if you're creating something that's more like in a creative realm, like, you know, an image, a play, a video, a movie, then those things are copyrighted. Right. So more of like literary type things are copyrighted. Yeah. And right. And the trademarking and the patenting can be very, very expensive, whereas the copyright is very inexpensive, you know, and very easy for, you know, anybody to be able to get. The other thing that's nice is it shows you right here, when is my work copyrighted? It says that it's copyright protected the moment it's created. Okay, so what that means is the minute that you create something, you actually have copyright protection from the U.S. Copyright Office. You automatically, it's yours, you own it. Nobody is supposed to be able to use it, even if you don't have it registered. Now, naturally, there could be a lot of gray area there. So you're going to have more protection if you register your works, right? Especially when you get into, you know, where people might be wanting to use it and pay you money. That kind of thing, right? Okay, so Mickey's asking, can you copyright a company logo and name to protect for trademarking later? Well, technically, like logos would be trademarked. You know, if it's like an image that you drew, you probably can get, you know, a copyright, but it's not like if it's considered a company logo, then no, that'd have to be trademarked. So, you know, you'd have to check with the office and, or you'd check with an intellectual property attorney, if you're interested down the line in doing any of this, unless it's something that's obvious, like, you know, a play, a video, a song, something like that, that you know that, you know, you're creating a movie, whatever it is, and you know that you just go straight to the copyright office. But they'll let you know, too, if your information can be copyrighted or which way you want to sway. But if it's something like, you know, a design, then you're going to trademark it. So if you think of like Nike, for example, when I say Nike and you think of that company, everybody can think of what that familiar symbol is, right? So that would be trademarked, right? That wouldn't be copyrighted. It would be trademarked. Yeah. So you'll talk more about this and you'll explore it a lot further again as you go through with your program. But for digital literacy in month one, what I want you guys to be aware of is that, you know, you can do this down the line. You're automatically protected. And also though, that you shouldn't be using materials that are copyrighted. And as Full Sail students, we want you guys to, again, be in the habit of not utilizing copyrighted materials because we want you to be acting as professionals in your field. And we want you to, you know, either find something you can use or create an original work of your own when you're deciding to copyright something. So nothing that's copyrighted can be used without permission legally. So nobody can go and grab an image or a song or a movie and use part of it, not even 5 seconds of it, not even 10 seconds. You know, there's no poor man's copyright. There's no amount of something that you're allowed to use that's copyrighted without permission from the copyright owner. So if you're wanting to know if you can use something or whether or not it's copyrighted, that's where you would want to check with the copyright office, see if something's copyrighted, and then contact that owner. So if you were to go to the homepage, like we were on a moment ago, copyright.gov, you could search the records to find out, you know, if something's registered, who owns it, and then you'd be able to, you know, ask permission. A lot of times, obviously, you know, you don't want to go this route because it might be more expensive. Naturally, you know, somebody might want thousands of dollars, right, in order for you to use their materials. So if that's the case where somebody might want thousands of dollars, you could look to other sources to get something similar. So we'll look at some things that you could do. Okay, so Mickey's saying that you tried to trademark your company. And it's almost like 300, then it's like 255 to submit to the government. Yeah, so right, it's for the trademarking stuff, that's expensive. So like copywriting portions of things is a lot cheaper than typically going for things like trademarks and patents and stuff like that. Okay, because copyright's, you know, so inexpensive, which is nice. Okay, so, you know, and copyright protection lasts a very long time. So when something's changed, it should be copyrighted again because technically the nature of that work changed and it needs to be recopyrighted. But when copyright runs out, it goes into what's called the public domain. And once something's in the public domain, it can be utilized by anybody without protection, right? So anything that anything before like 1923 is automatically in the public domain unless it's been changed and copyrighted again. But the idea here is that, you know, people should be able to use materials and information sharing and learning and things like that, right? So copyright doesn't last forever for that reason. It does last a very long time, though. It lasts, you know, close to 100 years. So it's a long time. It's probably going to be, if you create something good enough for like you and your children to get royalties on. And then naturally, if you, but this is all tied into this because you don't want to be using things that are copyrighted. This is part of the 9 elements of digital citizenship. So, but yes, you are, for anything that you create and any assignment, you need to be aware of these things because you want to make sure that you're utilizing materials in the right way. Even, like I said, as students, you have some leeway, but we want you to start out doing these things as professionals. And it's good to be aware of, because if you have a website, let's say on your own, and you use things you're not supposed to, you know, you can be cited for copyright infringement, just like a huge company. You're welcome. Yeah. So this is just for informational purposes, because it's important to know. Anytime you're writing, using other materials, creating something, you want to make sure that you're in compliance with these things, that you're doing things the way you should be doing them. So, you know, if you want to look more into this, that's the website, copyright.gov. So if we're talking about you guys doing an assignment or you're wanting to create something of your own, like a video for YouTube or your website or something like that, maybe you're getting your business going or you're creating your portfolio or whatever it might be, it's a good idea naturally to, thank you. It's a good idea naturally to get in the habit of, you know, using materials you should be able to use. And again, it doesn't matter, you know, who the person is, what their age is. If it's copyright infringement, it's copyright infringement. So you want to make sure you're doing things in the right way. So even like downloading materials you're not supposed to use is certainly a bad idea. So there's times that copyrighted material can be used, and that's gray, but we refer to that typically as like with fair use. So for example, students can use it, but again, we want you to be in the habit of not, as long as you're citing the material in an academic setting, that is, like for turning in an assignment. Not like in a commercial way of adding something to the web, right? Because that's publicly, you know, publishing something. So, for satire and news reporting, they have protection from fair use where they can use something. And when something goes into, everybody's very quiet today. And when something goes into the public domain, that means that it can be used. Once it goes into the public domain, that means the copyright protection has ended and it can be used. Well, since you're not supposed to use copyrighted materials without permission, what can you use, right? So if you go see an image that you like or a song that you like and you can't use that, what can you use? Well, you guys, you guys can use images that are, exactly, pricey lesson, or images or songs or videos that either you have licensing to, or a really good resource for you is called Creative Commons. So when I say that you have licensing for example, because you're enrolled at Full Sail, and at Full Sail we pay for you guys to have license, access and use to like West Star music. So you could use the music, clips and things from that, right? You could create your own. So you could use, because you're allowed to use those databases and things. You still have to cite it. You always cite something that you didn't create, but you're allowed to use them. Whereas copyrighted material, people are not allowed to use the copyrighted. So think of like buying software at home, right? Yeah. Think of buying, I do a lot of shopping on Amazon, a whole lot. So I get stuff delivered all the time. So think of, I'm very busy, so it helps to have packages show up at my door, every couple days. All right. So think of like if you buy software, and you have clip art in that software. Well, you're allowed to use that clip art, right? Yeah, the shipping's cheaper, right? So it's free if you're a Prime member like me, right? So you're allowed to utilize those clip art, let's say, within the software you bought, because you bought a license, right? You purchased that software, and that's part of that bundle that comes with it. So you know that if you use PowerPoint and you want to use their clip art, you're allowed to use that, right? Or you can go to sites like Stock Exchange, let's say, and use their photos that you're allowed to use, or pay a small fee and you're allowed to use it commercially, things like that, right? But you always want to look into what that licensing allows you to do. Yeah, so like with something like Stock Exchange, those kind of sites, you can get very inexpensive, photos and different kinds of multimedia that you're allowed to use in any way that you want, even commercially for a small fee. So Creative Commons is another thing that you could use as an option when you're wanting to have, different types of multimedia and things that you can use. And so if you wanted to check into Creative Commons, if something is created or protected with Creative Commons, it's a lot more lenient than copyright protection. So if it's licenses, Creative Commons, see how it says 882 million Creative Commons license works and counting. So if we look at this little infographic here, it shows you in 2014, last year, there were 882 million works that were licensed as Creative Commons. So Creative Commons licensing, see that? Big, right? So people are really using this now. Yeah. So the thing is you see right here where it says these are the different types of Creative Commons licensing types. And I know you guys have seen these licenses on things. So you might not have realized what it was, but that's what it is. So you can see where they've got, very open types of licensing. And then they've got less open. So some Creative Commons licenses are strict and close to copyright, but not quite as strict. And some are very, very open, where you can use that material however you want, or you can share it with people and let them use it however they want, as long as they attribute credit to you, which you always need to do that, or it's, you know, plagiarizing anyway. Okay, so it tells you right here, statistically, 58% allow commercial use. So now if you go to Creative Commons and you look for something, or you go to like Flickr and look for something that's Creative Commons, like an image you want to use, or Library of Congress, for example, you know, or PhotoBucket, or wherever you're looking for images and that kind of thing, if it's licensed Creative Commons that allows commercial use, you can even use it to make money, right? You could put it in your video that you're making money with, put it on your website that you're making money with. So that's what it means by allowing it for commercial use. And then 76% of all copy, or rather Creative Commons licensed material, allows for adaptations. So that means, in other words, you can change it to some degree depending on how strict that copyrighted, or rather Creative Commons licensed material is. Okay, well, that's interesting, Mickey. But, you know, there's a lot of things that are different because it's up to the owner of that material how they allow you to use it. So that typically isn't like something that's really like the state's involved with. That's, if I create an image and I tell you you're allowed to use it commercially, then you're allowed to use it commercially. You know what I mean? Because I'm the owner of the image and I can license it how I want and distribute that and allow people to utilize it however I want. Okay. So this shows you that people are utilizing this in different parts of the world. Worried about damaging water supplies. I don't understand. Okay. So you can see that we've got not, it shows you with this infographic that 9 million websites are using Creative Commons licensed material, which is awesome. So this is showing you a lot of the, you know, the different kinds of multimedia sites that are out there, like YouTube is showing that at the time of this infographic had 10 million different videos that were using, you know, Creative Commons licensed material, 307 million Flickr photos, Wikipedia, 30 million articles, and so forth. So you can see that in here it says that 14 countries have made national commitments to open education. And that's what this is about, right? It's about sharing of resources and not having such a lockdown on intellectual property where nobody can use it, right? Which is a great thing to be able to, you know, share resources and to be able to support this type of thing is a good thing. All right. So if you're wanting to use something, you could search anywhere and find Creative Commons licensed material, like going to Flickr, something like that. But if we look at, or here, you could come right to the site, you know, and search for like where it says explore right here. So if you want to find CC licensed works to use, you would be able to, you know, click here and find Creative Commons licensed work that you'd be able to use in your works. So you want to make sure you're finding the right licensed material and you're using it the right way. And there's a little kind of workshop they have here, worksheet that is, to help you select the type of license. And then it gives you the code that you can generate and put on your work right away, which is nice. So that's where that is. And about the licenses here. So it shows you here the different types of licenses, and you can see that there are six. And again, they go from quite strict, which is close to copyright, but not quite as strict, all the way to, you know, very lenient. So you can see right here, this is the most lenient here, CC BY. So all that means is you have to attribute the owner, you know, and you always need to attribute credit to the original owner, right? Or that's utilizing materials in the false way, like plagiarism. So attribution CC BY. It tells you this license lets others distribute, remix, tweak, and build upon your work, even commercially. So you could use something that's licensed like this in a commercial fashion to make money with, as long as they credit you for the original creation. This is the most accommodating of licenses offered, and it's recommended for maximum dissemination and use of licensed materials. So you guys can look through these if you're interested in utilizing Creative Commons material, which of course you will be at some point. And so even for assignments, again, it's best to utilize these kind of materials. We don't want you utilizing copyrighted materials even on your assignments at Full Sail. So this would be a good alternative to find materials that are not copyright protected, but are Creative Commons licensed instead, right? And the other thing, again, was things being in the public domain here, and here's a link to the public domain where you're allowed to use anything, again, that's in the public domain. You still always cite the source, right? You always pay, you know, attribution by giving credit to the original author of the material, but you are allowed to utilize those materials. Okay? All right, everybody with me still? Okay, good. All right, that's good. I know it's a lot of information, so this is something that you guys, you know, might want to be, you know, be looking into more. All right. So if we think about, finding things too that are copyright protected, I'm going to stop sharing my screen here for a minute. And you're working on an assignment. One thing that I love about working with Google Drive is they've got built-in features to help you guys create things right away with your work. So let's say that you were, you know what? Hold on, I want to do this with the presentation stuff. Oops, hold on, bear with me a second here. Okay, so let's say you wanted to use, like, for assignment 3.6, let's say that you wanted to use Google Slides because you need to use some kind of cloud-based presentation tool for that assignment. So if you wanted to use Google Slides, and yeah, right. Well, and Gary, as I mentioned before, you know, it was okay if it wasn't actually from the company, if it was a person, you know, working on a computer or creating something or whatever, you know, that would have been fine to have been used from AP Images. The idea here is that you're getting used to using these materials in the proper way and having access to AP Images, which is a professional organization, obviously huge, is a good thing. So utilizing that instead of copyrighted images was what we wanted you guys to understand that and to be able to have access to that is a nice thing too. Okay, so if you're working on assignment 3.6, for example, and you're using the, so I didn't count off, like if you didn't have, you know, logos or whatever from AP Images, as long as it somehow related to the material, you're fine. So for assignment 3.6, right, let's say you're using Google Slides for your presentation and you guys are going to be researching the Sochi Olympics of 2014 and you want to determine, I mean, you guys need to go through the instructions and the rubric and all that, but you want to you know, look at how the 9 elements of digital citizenship played a role in this and break it down with things like, you know, digital communication. How did that work? Digital security was huge in the Sochi Olympics. So, and even like all kinds of digital technologies, there were a big thing with Samsung, with the cell phones being the official provider. I mean, you name it. People using Twitter to talk about how their hotel rooms weren't up to par. All kinds of things. So, so you want to be doing this research on this assignment, and you want to relate it to, again, the 9 elements of digital citizenship and break it down. You don't have to cover all 9 elements, but I'd say definitely cover, you know, 4 or 5 of them in the assignment and how those related to the events before, after, and or during with the Sochi Olympics of 2014. So we're seeing these days that information can be spread very, very rapidly, right? Through channels like Twitter. And if any of you guys have had the chance, I know a lot of you have already, to watch the Markham Nolam video, right, of this week, where he talks about how you analyze information for its credibility and how quickly information spreads, like with, you know, the hurricane, or rather the tornado that happened in Chile. And within 30 seconds, you know, somebody had tweeted it, and people within 30 seconds could know, you know, across the world about this horrible event, you know, about this earthquake that had happened. So look into those types of things with the digital citizenship. So if you're working on this assignment and you're wanting to utilize images, let's say, for this assignment, you want to make sure, right, that you're not utilizing copyrighted images. So one thing that I really like about any of the Google Suite tools, there is what's called the research toolbar. So if you go to tools here and then you click research, I can type in, if I wanted to get images, right, I could choose images. Now here's one of my favorite filtering results here. Automatically by default, it's not filtered by image by usage rights, right? But I can filter through Google Drive here, free to use, share, or modify even commercially. So now I'm going to, isn't that awesome? So now I'm going to find images for whatever topic I want that are either Creative Commons, copyright free, that kind of thing. Well, that's interesting. Okay, so here we go. So if I type in Sochi Olympics, now it's only going to give me images I can use. Beautiful, right? Boom. How easy is that? So now when we think of, and AP Images, naturally, you can use that. You could go to Flickr. But I love this tool right through the Google Suite of applications because it allows me to filter right there within Google. Yeah, isn't that awesome? And then I'm able to use it. So I could do this for, not just images, but I could do it for videos, right? Now nothing's coming up, so I could change my, in week two, we had you guys use the search operators. I could change my search operators. If I wanted a quote, you know, now the quotes in the videos, I probably want to, for a quote, I want to take off, because obviously for a quote, all I need to do is I want to take off the filtering, right? Because a quote's different, right? A quote's definitely different. I can just cite the quote as written material and be fine with that. Okay. So I've got my results here for the Sochi Olympics with images that I'm allowed to use. Okay. So I would take that off, obviously, if I'm wanting like a quote. So, okay. Now I don't want to use these, right? Because I didn't filter them. But if I wanted to find, you know, a quote from the Sochi Olympics, or I wanted to find, articles on it as my research, I can do my research right in here. So here, this is giving me all different kinds of, you know, results. So like, for example, here's 14 unforgettable moments, but probably what I want to do, just typing in Sochi Olympics doesn't give me a lot of information, right? So I could say like Sochi Olympics and security, right? So if I'm thinking about the 9 elements of digital citizenship, right? So Sochi Olympics and security. Okay, now I'm coming up with some serious stuff. So now we can see, like, if I click on this link to see if I want to use this article, and, you know, it's telling me interesting information about that. And there are all kinds of articles and things about the big security measures that they took in Russia with the Sochi Olympics. So now I would be getting somewhere, right? I could use this as an article if I think that it's credible and would want to use it, for my presentation. So remember, I'm relating to the elements of digital citizenship. So this would be digital security, right? And how that took place. So you can see like this article right here, tight security at the Sochi Olympics. So this is obviously from a news article. Yes, and you could highlight and bookmark it in Digo, right? So you could do your research right through this tool, a lot of it, and start saving those right in Digo. So this would again be, oh, is it? That's odd. Huh. Hopefully the recording will come out okay. Is anybody else having that problem? Maybe if I turn up my volume a little randomly. Huh. Oh, what's my computer wanting to update? Oh, wow. I don't know why that is. Shouldn't be. Okay. So hopefully if you miss anything, okay, well, some of you hear me fine, so that's good. If you miss anything, do refer to the archive, because I will be archiving this and putting it up by tomorrow afternoon. So this tells you all different kinds of...
Don't let those arms turn to noodles during the month of watching games.
Stay what's this? Okay, this has got some kind of ad, I guess. I don't know if you can hear that. Oh, that's the ad. But anyway, so you guys can see that this article might have some elements about digital security that you would want to use, and then you can relate it to the events as the instructions talk about. So you can see I was able to pull that right up from Google, which is nice. If you want to, so there's all kinds of things. Digital commerce, right? You could talk about, the elements of how, money was made and exchanged, or anything you would want with digital commerce. The revenue that was brought into Russia for the Sochi Olympics. The lack of decent accommodations. A lot of people were talking about that. There was huge, security was big, right? So digital security, that was huge for the Olympics. So I'm not going to go into the details with all this, because this is what you guys are researching naturally. I'm just giving you guys some ideas. So you could put those things in. So I could say for example, Sochi Olympics and electronic commerce, right? And see what I yield. And, I'll come up with some different results. So look into it and see, so I could talk about how different sponsors, right, played a role. Digital health and wellness, that's big, right, with athletes naturally, and how they did things. So you guys get the idea. So take, four or five of the nine elements of digital citizenship and see how they related to the huge event of, and how they impacted the event of the Sochi Olympics. So look thoroughly into the instructions to make sure that you guys aren't missing any of that. And I'll have a Q&A session tomorrow. So between now and tomorrow, look into those instructions and things, start maybe doing a little research and that kind of thing. And you guys all have the chance to ask questions as you're moving forward. So if I wanted to, so again, that's how you could find right through the Google tool images and so forth that you could use, that again, if you filter it by free to share, use, modify, even commercially. So these would be things that images that you would be able to use that wouldn't be copyright protected. So again, you're not required to use research databases for this assignment, but you're more than welcome to, if you'd like to explore utilizing EBSCOhost, LexisNexis, AP Images, Westar Music, if you want to add music to it. Any of the library research databases, naturally, you can utilize any of those things anytime you want, which is great. So this is nice because I could add these things right in here. Another thing that's great with the Digo research tool is you can also, okay, let me see if I wanted to. Where is that? Oh, no wonder I'm still on images. Okay, so if I go up to, let's say, articles and things, so I've got my website for articles. Notice I can do insert link and insert the link to it as a citation right into my presentation as well. It's pretty nifty, right? That's a nice feature there with the Google research tool as well. And right here, so it's giving me this option now because I'm not on images. So I could also use this citation format, which you don't have to formally cite with MLA, APA, or Chicago style yet. But like when you get into your English class, you will need to know how to do formal citations. And this is what typically, you know, is used in the business world is AP image citations. So it allows you to utilize the AP image style if you were wanting, you know, to use that. So APA image citation style, but not required. Again, I just wanted to show you guys that in case, you know, for when you are required to use the APA imaging citation style, which is the American Psychological Association style. And again, you'll learn more about that when you get to English. But this is a great tool, as you can see, to work with on your assignment because you've got those built-in things to help you do the research and to help you use like images and things that aren't copyrighted, that are free to use even commercially, that you're allowed to use. So everybody with me on that? Good? Everybody good? Okay, good. All right. So yeah, right? Exactly. So a lot of the tedious work from, you know, citation, having to do all that and all that stuff is very, yes, has been made easy with these types of tools, which is really nice. So Gary's saying, would it be okay if you used different domestic issues as reference for each vocab word? Okay, well, it has to be related to the Sochi Olympics, Gary. So you have to, that has to be the topic for this assignment. So we've used, yeah, that's okay. We've used different topics, but for this assignment, we're viewing, you know, in the past, we've used different topics and how social media and different elements of digital citizenship played a role in changing the event, but, or shaping the event. But in this case, we're looking at the Sochi Olympics. Yeah. So good question, because you want to make sure you do that and relate it to the Sochi Olympics. So Edward's saying that so much of the old tedious work now is automated. Right. So that's right. So the research tool I love, it's one of my favorite things with using any of the Google Suite programs because it makes doing it so easily, as you can see, where you can, you know, search for copyright free and that kind of thing and easily cite your images and all that good stuff. So no, Gary, I'm glad you asked. That's a very good question. Always good. That's why we're here, to clear things up and for you guys to learn. So that's good. So another thing you might want to use and do for assignment 3.6 is you could go directly to news sites, for example, right? You could go directly to Twitter, for example. So what if I went right to twitter.com? Twitter might harm, huh? Okay, let's see what's going on here. Did I type that in right? Oh no, I have two eyes, I think. Okay. There we go. Uh-huh. Okay. So if I go Isn't that interesting? I accidentally did a typo. Okay, so if I go directly to Twitter and I'm wanting to search you know, I changed my password, so this might not let me in here. All right, so I'm not going to log into my Twitter right now. But if I went directly to Twitter, you know, and I wanted to search, you know, Sochi Olympics, I'm just going to do a Google search since mine's not, and Twitter. So here we go, Sochi 2014 on Twitter, and now I'm getting all kinds of things. So I could search directly in Twitter, right? And I could find things of how, and I could look at these and get ideas. Here's transfer of knowledge between the 2014 organizers and the future host cities. So that would be digital communication, right? You know, all kinds of things. So you can go directly to the sites and that kind of thing. Yes, I'm on Twitter. I don't like it when it does these little pop-ups when I'm trying to show you guys things. So I could do that. I could go directly to sites like that that are social media in nature, for example. I could go to Facebook and get information and see how people were utilizing that tool in a, you know, for elements of digital citizenship. Break it down again, choose like 4 to 5 of them, and then look at the instructions, and you're going to look at how those elements help shape and were a part of the event for the 2014 Sochi Olympics. Okay, good. Everybody on the same page with me? All right, good. So I want you guys, again, I know it's still only Wednesday, so if you have time, try to make time, if you're attending my live lab session tomorrow, to look into the instructions tomorrow, and then maybe start doing a little of your research and that kind of thing. And then tomorrow we'll hold a week 3 Q&A session for any specific questions or help you guys need as you get rolling on this assignment before the weekend comes around. So the phrase of the day, Mickey, thank you for reminding me, is the 9 elements of digital citizenship. So that's the phrase of the day for the attendance form, the 9 elements of digital citizenship. So remember, same form as always for my labs. So you guys want to fill that out and plug that in with today's special phrase or topic. So on that note, does anybody have any questions for, anything that we talked about today? Remember, specifically for the assignment, we'll address the more detailed things after you guys have a chance to look at it. Remember that you do have your week 3 discussion post, the initial one due this evening before 11:50, before 11:59 p.m. Eastern Standard Time this evening. And you do have replies due by Sunday as well. Keep that in mind, right? Okay, so if you're done with that, that's good. If you need, look and see what your classmates have posted. Remember to be creative with that. And I do talk about that in the yesterday's global session. So remember, it's the idea is to get you guys thinking about how these tools and utilizing these things can shape things and change things and alter things actually in a dramatic way, and how something could have turned out differently if they had the availability of that. So we want you to think along those lines and be creative with it, have fun with it, and get that initial post in before midnight tonight, right? Good. And if you want to, create a little fictitious story or something, you're welcome to do that, just as long as you're relating it to how it would have been different with utilizing different technologies of today. So think about, like yesterday, we talked about digital security in the global session, or if you attended someone else's, and we looked at things like VeraXF and, the geolocation tracking and McAfee case and all that interesting stuff, right? So good stuff. So yeah, lots of interesting topics this week. So remember, you've got the different forums where we're talking about these things. So make sure you go into those separate forums and read what your classmates are posting and what I'm posting, and you comment and you do those little activities and stuff, which will help you understand the 9 elements of digital citizenship further. So that's all good. Okay, so I don't see any hands up. So again, do review the assignment instructions and rubric and try to start doing a little of your research for this assignment. And then we'll come back again tomorrow for our other week 3 lab, and we'll talk about these things. Sound good? All right. Awesome. Okay. Well, you guys have, yes, and lots of inspiration, lots of good info on the discussion boards. Remember, you learn from one another, which is great. And that's a big benefit of online learning naturally. So yes, good stuff. Oh, wait for what? So you guys have an awesome afternoon, and I don't see any hands up. And Mickey, are you typing? Yes, you can type out the Revere report. You can, you can do that in whatever creative fashion you want. Just make sure it's there on the 3.4 discussion forum. If you want to utilize other tools for that and create something, creative, like an image, or you're welcome to do that. You're not required to, but, I always like to see some creativity. That's always interesting. So you guys can utilize other tools with that if you want, but you're not required to. Yeah, no, it doesn't have to be a story. It doesn't have to be. You can just talk about it like some students are doing and how it would have affected the event. But if you wanted to get creative and do like a little story with it, you're welcome to. Yep, so good stuff. So you guys have an awesome afternoon. Thank you for joining. Thank you for your participation. And I'll see you in tomorrow's lab if you can make it. And you guys have a great evening.